So let's get started in talking about motivation. So one of the things that we have to do when we're talking about motivation is to decide what matters and why you're going to set a goal. And we've been talking about the challenges of prioritizing what you want to do, that many of you can do a brain dump, but it's harder to figure out what's most important and when to get to it. So you've got to know actually when you're thinking about motivation, what it is you want to do and why you want to do it before you address any task or establish the goal associated with it. So we want to ask ourselves, what do I want to achieve and why is this goal important? And that's something that we also want to do with our kids. What do you want to achieve and why is this important? I'm just saying a few hellos while I'm pausing. Hi, Heather. Hi, Kara. Hi, Valerie. Welcome. So when you think about motivating, you have to really understand, you know, why, what, where, when, how, all of these questions will be relevant. One of the challenges, I think, for people with ADHD in motivating themselves is to create realistic expectations of what you're capable of. What are the available resources you have, and what are your time constraints? And this is true for your children as well. We as parents really need to think about what are our kids actually capable of at this stage right now? How can we meet them where they are? What are resources that we can rely on? And what are the time constraints? Because as you remember a few weeks ago, when we talked about planning and prioritizing, that planning and prioritizing have so much to do with urgency, that time factor, and importance, that value. And so we need to lay those out in the beginning when we're thinking about the topic of motivation. Now, a lot of people who have ADHD think that, or have been told that they are lazy. And I don't believe that. Dana's saying, yes, timing, that's always an issue. Erica is saying, I slipped through the cracks as a child. Now I'm trying to figure out how to stay motivated while looking for a job I can do. How can I stay motivated? That's a great question, Erica, and we're going to come back to that. So what I want to say something about is that about willpower. So a lot of people have heard with ADHD that they're lazy or they don't have enough willpower. And ADHD is not a lack of willpower, but rather a condition of being unable to harness the abilities you have to motivate yourself on something that might not interest you or might interest you but seems really hard or complicated, and then apply yourself to something that has that challenge to be able to say, okay, well, you know, I'm interested in this, but it seems too hard. I'm going to avoid it, the avoidance procrastination, or I'm interested in this. I really want to do it, but I'm overwhelmed. So I'd like to go back to Erica, if you don't mind, and your task about looking for a job. So how can you stay motivated? Looking for a job can be one of the most discouraging and dispiriting things adults can do because you send out your resumes, you send out a cover letter, and you may hear nothing back. And that is so, that can just, you know, it just feels bad, you know, particularly if you have ADHD and you're sensitive to rejection. That's a rejection right there. You didn't even get a chance. You know, you tossed your hat in the ring, but you didn't even get your hat picked up. So what I want you to think about when you're applying for a job are small steps and small successes. So when you're in order to stay motivated when you have this enormous task of looking for a job, what you want to think about is what is my plan? Like, what is your map for looking for a job? So do you check Indeed or Monster every day? Or do you have some places you already want to apply to, but you're struggling with the cover letter? Have you put your resume together? And do you feel like it's in a solid place? So when you look for a job, you know, it's not an all-day experience, right? Perhaps it can be. Perhaps writing that cover letter might take a lot of hours, but we want to try to put some boundaries around it so that you work for a little while, you take a break, you work for a little while, you take a break, and maybe you're finished. So how can you stay motivated? By breaking things down and chunking them. There's really no other way to do it with tasks we don't enjoy. And I can't say this enough. So when you need to stay motivated, you have to break down what you're doing, where you're applying. And when you're done, say to yourself, okay, that's good. Check it off so that you have a list so you can see that you've accomplished something. I have had this list, this is a really overwhelming list, for over a week now. And I still am avoiding the two biggest tasks, but I have checked off a lot of the other things, and I actually feel a sense of accomplishment. And so when you're applying for a job or you have a task that's unpleasant, how you're going to stay motivated is to break things down and then to break them down again. So for my list, I put the task, I put the due date. I couldn't estimate the time for some of those things, but I put like when I want to work on them. And then that helped me like Thursday morning or Thursday afternoon after lunch so that I had a little bit of a sense of when I was going to do it. And then, of course, unexpected things happen and I didn't get to them. And here I am Friday on my writing day doing things like billing. So it's, you know, it's sometimes the best laid plans don't come to fruition, but it's important to break down what you have to do when you're applying for a job to so that you can see that you're making some progress. The other thing is how you're talking to yourself about looking for a job. You know, it takes time and energy. I don't know what the average time is for looking for a job and finding it, but I would imagine it's somewhere between 3 or 3 and 6 months. And maybe it happens less than that, but it does take time. And if you're looking for like an immediate response, you may end up feeling very disappointed. So what's the bandwidth, right? You send your resume, you send your cover letter, and you don't hear anything. When can you check back? Probably within, I would say, 5 to 7 days. I sent my resume, I'm just following up, I'm wondering, you know, what the timeline is. And that's a gentle and kind way to reach out to people. So I'm gonna move off the looking for a job, but I would love to hear from the rest of you what kinds of things are really hard to get motivated for. What are the things that you don't wanna do that you have to do? So please put in the chat, what are some of the things that you don't wanna do that you have to do? Now, I said I was talking about willpower and laziness, right? And so willpower, when we think about ADHD, sometimes people think, oh, I just don't have enough willpower. I don't have enough stick-to-itiveness. And I actually think it's the opposite. I think you have so much willpower because every day you get up and you do things that are challenging for you. So we want to learn how to motivate ourselves for things we don't like. And this includes helping our kids get motivated for homework. And the way that we're going to do this is the same thing, is this idea of breaking it down. So when we think about willpower, that condition of being with ADHD, it's not that you lack willpower, but you have struggled to harness the abilities you have to motivate yourself for something that's not interesting or doesn't seem fun or seems pretty tedious. But willpower is sometimes confused with grit. And many people with ADHD are perceived as not having grit or not having willpower. What they have is differential motivation. They're motivated for some things that interest them because of the dopamine amounts in their brain and the pathways, and they don't lack as much willpower or grit for the things that are more challenging. And I actually feel like grit is a term that I want to flip on its head in a few minutes, because I don't think grit is a trait. I think it's a process. So let me go back to some of these questions, because the comments and stuff. So let's see. Zoe asked, how do you get a 7-year-old to do homework? There are a couple ways to do that. One, you have family work time. So you sit at the table while they're doing their homework and you're present to answer any questions. You think about or you observe or you talk to the teacher for how long your child can actually focus before they need a break. And you break down the homework into work periods for that length of time with short body breaks, bathroom breaks, water breaks, petting the cat breaks in between. And that is how you're going to get them to do the homework. A small chunk, a little bit of a reward, a small chunk, a little bit of reward. And I think it's worth talking to the teacher once you have a sense of how long your child can actually concentrate, how much time is expected to do the homework for your child given their challenges. So I'm looking at some things that are motivational challenges: schoolwork and reading, cleaning, making a phone call. Yes, many people with ADHD struggle with phone calls, house chores, cleaning, opening mail and paying bills, housework, organizing your apartment, piles, closet, clutter, filing papers at home, helping my son catch up on his math homework. I'm going to come back to that, Audrey. Getting overwhelmed no matter what I've tried, making healthy family dinners most nights, and oh yes, cooking. Yep, being an adult is rough. It is. Okay, so what I want to say is something about the homework question, and then I want to get into the adult issue, catching up on your math homework. So usually if kids have missed school or they have missed work, it is doubly difficult to do it because they have to do what they need to do to stay current, and then they have to do this other stuff that they have to keep up with. And what I want to encourage you to do is to break down the catch-up homework into small pieces. You do a little bit every day rather than trying to do the whole thing at once. Some kids who like to hyper-focus might want to do that, but I would imagine most kids would prefer if they do a little bit one day and a little bit another until they get finished, and to try to break it up into days of the week. Otherwise, it's overwhelming. Ugh, I have all this math to catch up on, plus the math I have to do. I can't do all those things. So let's see. So I want to say something about Angie says schoolwork and reading. Someone said opening mail and paying bills and housework. So here's something that I want you to think about. Can you consider that there is a good way of approaching a task? Because actually, when you're doing a task or you finish it, you feel positive. So can you transform your disinterest into some kind of interest? Is there some aspect of paying the bills or cleaning or doing the chores that not only interests you, but might be something that you could delegate or get assistance with? If you're struggling to do something, it might help to have a body double. And that's true when kids have to do homework, when they have to practice their instrument, when they have makeup work. It might be true when you're doing your work that it's helpful if you have a partner or someone else is working in the same area that you are. And that's why I really like family work time or partner work time. You're paying the bills and maybe your partner is doing a work project or doing crossword puzzles or something, but it's a quiet time where everyone is thinking and doing things together. When you're faced with organizing your apartment, with dealing with piles and clutter, we've spoken before that it helps to have someone with you, someone who can talk you through it, someone who can assist you in the areas where you might feel weaker. And that's something, sometimes we call that delegation, but a lot of times what I call that is a body double. Somebody who is just there to kind of like cheer you on and help you work your way through something that you don't really like. Let's see, some questions. It gets overwhelming no matter what I've tried. So Tanya, what I would suggest is doing a little bit less. You know, when you're overwhelmed, then you haven't broken the task down into a small enough chunk. And when you're cooking dinner, for example, and I love that there are all these resources on attitude for cooking dinner is something that is very challenging for a lot of people with ADHD because it uses a lot of your executive functioning skills simultaneously. And also, when you're cooking dinner, there is an aspect of multitasking. You have to keep track of one dish while you're doing the other. And so for people who struggle with making dinner or that kind of task, have someone assist you. Have your kids come in and be the take the vegetables out of the refrigerator helpers, or you know, learn, teach them to tear up the lettuce to make a salad, or maybe they can dump the pasta in the boiling water and watch the timer themselves. So help yourself by sort of separating out the tasks to other people who are around you. Monica says, I have so many different ideas on things I want to do, but I feel paralyzed and confused when I want to start. So often what happens, Monica, is that you're overwhelmed. You've overwhelmed yourself with all your ideas of what you want to do and how you want to do it. And so what you need to do is sort of simplify the field. So pick one thing you want to work on. And if you're not sure where to start, think about the different parts of the thing you have to do. So, you know, take a piece of paper and write down, or do it on your computer or your phone. If I'm going to clean the kitchen, I need to mop the floor. I need to wipe down the counters. I need to put away the clean dishes. Okay, great. Is that something you have to do all by yourself? Do you live with people who could help you put the forks in the fork little area and the knives in the knife area? Kids are it's very helpful for kids to put away the silverware because it's a very simple task and they can't break it. And then you can think about what you want to do next. It's really important that you take these complicated things and you break them into small enough pieces so you can say, oh, I can do this one thing. Otherwise, you're not going to be able to start. Maya asks, how can I motivate my son to practice his saxophone? He likes playing the instrument but hates practicing and sees it as taking up his free time after homework. It takes a lot to set up to put the instrument together, so it's kind of hard to break it into chunks. He's got to stay at it for 15 minutes, but to him it's an eternity. So Maya, that's a great question. One of the clients I work, they actually practice their instrument before school, so that after school is homework and then free time. I'm wondering if that might be possible for your son. The instrument is put together at one point, before breakfast and then practiced after breakfast. Or maybe the instrument is put together before homework and then played after homework. Or maybe the instrument is played before homework altogether, and then there's a little bit of a break and then homework. So those are a couple ideas I have. Zoe, we do much of that. She is okay for things where it's a competition or easy. Yes, because she's seven. And they never take her long, but it's the things that are hard. She will spend 20 minutes battling for 10 minutes of work. Right. So when it's hard, you know, for a child who's young like that, they really can't sustain the concentration and focus to overcome the struggle. Like the struggle is bigger than any reward of actually accomplishing anything. So if it's taking her 20 minutes to do 10 minutes of work, I would actually have a little meeting with her teacher and with your daughter and talk about how can I do 10 minutes of work at home in a way that I can finish it and not have a meltdown. You know, this is what I mean about asking for help. You know, let the teacher assist you in figuring out how to do this, because you can't do this on your own. It's a lot to ask. Tanya, I've used HelloFresh meal delivery system with a family of four, three boy athletes who are always hungry. The program actually lowered my monthly food budget and my boys enjoy making the meals with me. High five, Tanya. That's brilliant. I find it harder to get things done if there's someone nearby, watching nearby, or even at home. Great. So that's good to know. And so if it's harder to get things done if someone's nearby, watching, or even home, then you have limited windows of time to get stuff done. And Zoe's saying she can't do her housework with her husband at home. And I don't know if that's because he interferes or he doesn't help at all and he makes things more complicated. So if you need to be alone, then I think the best thing to help you do stuff is your phone. You know, to set an alert or an alarm. There are digital alerts and alarms as well to help you get started and do things. And that might be an easier way to do it. Or you might want to have an accountability buddy if you have a coach or a friend who's a student and say, okay, you know, let's study at 2 o'clock. You do it at your house, I'll do it mine. And then we'll touch base in 30 minutes just to give each other a little support. Angie, it's like performance anxiety. I see. So then that's what I would suggest. I would suggest someone that you can, who's a classmate or a friend or a family member who you can touch base with and say, I'm starting my work and I'll touch base with you in 30 or 40 minutes and let you know how it's going, or in an hour, or whatever makes sense for you. You're welcome, Dan. Grace, how do I as an adult make friends? I moved recently. I have 2 sons. I'd love to meet people, but I'm socially inept. I don't know where to start. My husband is a boat captain and is gone for months. I'm so lonely. Oh, Grace, I'm so sorry to hear that. We're not talking necessarily about making friends here today, but what I would say is if you have sons and they're at home and they're school age, that is a great place to make friends, to participate in school activities, whether it's a parent-teacher organization or, you know, sports teams or music like orchestra or theater. If you can meet some people through their activities, that might be a good place to start. You also might want to join a support group or two online, just so you have a community of people that you can lean on. Donnie Field, my daughter is 13 in 8th grade and has no sense of urgency of time. I wake her up every morning. Why can't she get herself up? So a lot of kids who are in the middle of puberty struggle with time. A lot of kids with ADHD have the sort of sleep-wake cycle disruptions. And, you know, what I would encourage you to do is to, you know, get an alarm clock, maybe 2, one that's near her bed, one that's across the room, and set that, and then you can come in as a follow-up. But I would talk with her about the stress in the mornings for you and for her. Remember that your 13-year-old and any of your other children, that in the areas where they struggle with their executive functioning skills, there's a lag in maturity of up to 3 years. So she might be more like a 10-year-old in this area, in which case being time blind would make sense. In fact, many people with ADHD have time blindness. Zoe, get a sack stand so it's out. I love that. Okay. Oh, Oksana, hi. I clean when my emotions fly off the handle. 1, cleaning gets done. 2, helps me relax and cool off. That's great. So you're taking out your upset and your aggression on your kitchen or your living room, and then you're done. You're like, wow, I actually feel better because I distracted myself and I got some stuff out, and look, my room is cleaner. Monica, you talk about making 1 pot meal so you don't have to worry about cooking things separately and prep while you're waiting for the pasta. That makes sense. Thank you, Annie, for this friendship resources. Meetups, yes. Moms Club International, thank you. You're welcome, Donniefield. Barbara, the more I have to do, the better I am. I need to stay focused or I feel tired and anxiety sets in. When I cook, my husband is always in the kitchen and he doesn't cook. I see. So that could be kind of stressful for me if my husband was just sitting in the kitchen and I'm doing everything. So either I would delegate something to my husband, or I'd say, since you're not helping me cook, could you please go in another room? I appreciate that you're me might be keeping me company, but it's actually frustrating for me, or it's distracting, and I just want to keep my focus on the food. Really non-blaming, very, very simple. So I want to say a few things about grit. So remember I said that I think that grit is a process, not necessarily a trait. I want to talk about grit as a process, okay? And you can use grit to help manage your everyday tasks. And in fact, I have a handout, which I'm going to get for you right now on the, hold on a second. Here we go. This is a handout. I've given it out before, but in case you haven't, you found it, I'm just laying it out right now for you so you can have this. So grit, let's start with G, get situated. Think about your tasks, remember, and do a brain dump of what needs to get done. And then just block off with a piece of paper everything except the first three items. Then write where and when you want to do them. Take your first item and your second item and break them down into smaller pieces, maybe with some times, maybe with what you need. And when those are finished, then you can move on to the third. But you have to get yourself situated when you're trying to motivate yourself, okay? And you when I say get situated, I mean literally get situated. Like, what do you need? If you're doing some schoolwork, sit yourself down, have your cup of tea, have your book, be ready to do what's in front of you. R, resist distraction. And this is a tough one, but you want to sort of ask yourself, you know, how long can I do something before I get bored? It's the same question we want to ask our children. How long can they do something before they get bored? If it's 20 minutes, then it's 20 minutes. Write yourself, if you do something for 20 minutes and then you need a break, write yourself a note on the document, on a post-it of what you were doing or the thought you had in your head, and then take your break with a timed amount and come back to the thing. So, and this note will help you ease back into it. Don't try to do something for an hour if that's an unrealistic expectation. Perhaps it's an unrealistic expectation for your daughter to do 10 minutes of homework every day. It's 10 minutes of work, but for her, it's 20. And so maybe that's not the most realistic thing. Maybe it needs to be 5 minutes and then 5 minutes. I'm not sure. So you want to try not to criticize yourself and engage in the what is wrong with me that I can't blah, blah, blah. You know, we're all about the positive self-talk. So you're going to resist distractions and you're going to have a plan for when you are distracted, what you're going to do when you get back. You will drift. What do you do when you return from the drift to let you know what you were doing before the drift? So that's something that I'd like to ask. How many of you notice when you drift off? And what do you do to try to get yourself back into whatever you were doing? How many of you notice when you drift off? And what do you do to get yourself back into whatever you were doing? And this would go for parents as well. Do your children notice when they drift off? And what do they do when they get back from the drift? So that's the G, get situated. R, resist distraction. I, implement incentives that matter. And yes, that actually is incentives for us also. You know, some of you have said in the past that you, if you had a bunch of dishes to do and you wanted to watch your show and you were tired, you might leave the dishes in the sink, but you might do the dishes and then watch your show. So I'd like you to think about, you know, what incentivizes you to get something done. And in fact, take a minute right now and put that in the comment. What incentivizes you to get something done? Something that you don't want to do that may not be inherently pleasant to do. What incentivizes you to get something done? Tracy, I've put my downloadable up above in the chat, so you can download that. This information is there. So you want to start with small steps and identify achievable goals. And that's where a lot of people struggle because they set goals for themselves, but they're not actually realistic. So you want to identify achievable goals. We want to put the have to before the want to for our kids, for sure, but also for us, and use incentives, things we enjoy, whether it's Instagram, whether it's you know, sitting outside in the sun and reading a book or watching a show or talking on the, you know, FaceTiming some friends, whatever it is you like to do, that's the incentive to get you started. So, you know, watch your TV show after you empty the trash. Meet your friend for coffee after you turn in a big work project. Use incentives that matter to kids as well and collaborate with them on setting up the agreement. So what are some things? Let's see what you've said. Oops, sorry. How I will feel after it's done. Thank you, Char, for saying that. So one of the things as adults we have, because we have a more fully developed prefrontal cortex, much more fully developed than our children, is that we have experience of doing something we don't like and knowing that we feel good afterwards. And so I think that's important, you know, to really think about, I know I hate doing this right now, but I'm gonna feel better after it's done. And that's that will get us through. And sometimes it won't get you through enough. Because no matter how good you know you're going to feel, the actual process of doing what you need to do, it just stinks. And in those cases, you've got to like break it down into smaller increments. So I'm not going to do all my billing today. I'm going to do, you know, A to M, and then I'll do N to Z tomorrow, so that I feel like I've gotten some of it done, but I can't stand doing it. So I'm going to try break it into chunks. Cassandra, any advice on how to wake a grizzly bear masquerading as a 10-year-old girl in the morning? Nearly every morning turns into a battle. To say she's tetchy is putting it mildly. Having ADHD myself, it's a challenge to be patient, especially when I'm supposed to be focusing on going to work. Right. So here's the thing. If you want your morning routine to work smoothly, then you've got to incentivize your kids about how they wake up for earning something they want later in the day or even, you know, right away. Now, I'm not a fan of screen time before school, but you could set up something that says, you know, if you wake up and you go back to sleep only once, and then the second time you're actually up and out of the bed, you can earn 15 minutes of bonus screen time. And kids are all about the bonus screen time or the bonus whatever. Maybe your daughter would want a bonus game, actually playing cards or a board game with you or doing a puzzle. So you want to kind of talk to her about what an incentive might be and attach that to the morning, because just like you don't like the morning battles, your kids don't like those battles. That's a terrible way to start your day to go to school. So I would encourage you to, you know, try to come up with a routine where they can earn some points for something that they really want. Anita, we get our kids to set the table and then they can go on tech. Exactly. They do the have to and then the want to. Tracy, Instagram Reels is an incentive. Zoe, losing weight and getting fit. Okay, so you want to be able to ski holes, which I don't understand what that is because I'm not a skier, but that's an incentive for you. All right, Char, you said you'll feel better when it's done. Susan, I hate dirty dishes in the sink. Right, so what happens in that situation is, Susan, you hate the dirty dishes more than that experience of hatred of those dirty dishes is more intense than actually the lack of interest in doing that in that task. So that's going to motivate you to clean those dishes to get it done. Kristen, daughter says treats and gifts and snuggles. I say the thought of how good the end result will feel. So here's the thing we want to think about. There are two types of motivation. Extrinsic, something that's outside of you, that's an outside demand or request. For kids, you need to fill out your permission form and bring it back so you can go on a field trip. For adults, it's like we've got to renew our license or we can't drive. That's an extrinsic motivator. It's external. Intrinsic motivation is doing something because it makes you feel good. okay? That the results are going to feel good. And that might be you want to run 3 miles instead of two. You might want to reach the next level on a game. You clean the kitchen because you hate having dirty dishes in the sink. Intrinsic motivation coalesces in our brains in the late teens to early 20s. And that is actually, there can be up to a 3-year delay in that for kids with ADHD. So the thought of just feeling how it's going to feel good when you're done is often not enough to motivate kids with ADHD. We want to use the extrinsic motivators, those incentives, until that intrinsic motivation kicks in, or until they're able to set up for themselves, I'm going to do this have to, and then I'm going to do this want to. Susan, I'm not a fan of clutter. That's a motivator. Barbara, items undone are visual stress, so completing them relieves stress. Yes, so that is, these are all intrinsic motivators. I feel better when, okay? Susan, it makes me peaceful to have a clean house. That's a huge motivator, right? Peter, I try and even make achievable goals, but cannot even find the courage or motivation because I get so overwhelmed, even for the smallest of tasks. Peter, that sounds very, very difficult. And I don't know if you're working with a coach or a therapist, but I think working with someone might be very helpful for you to reduce your overwhelm so that you can start something small and have help breaking things down into small enough chunks. Oksana. So if you are sending an incentive before the task, won't you be distracted thinking about the reward by working? Maybe, maybe not. You might actually feel like thinking about the task, you know, you might keep going back to the distraction. That could happen. Most of the time what I find for particularly kids with ADHD is that, you know, they know the reward is there and they know that they need to do this thing before they get that thing. Jennifer, going for a walk with your BFF. Fantastic. Lynn, I've never been able to use an incentive to get my kids to do what needs to get done. Well, Lynn, I'd love to hear more about that. I'm curious about why. Cassandra, I can see the TV from my kitchen, so I watch a show while I work in the kitchen, or I'll put on favorite music and listen to that while I do chores around the house. It helps me focus and always have. I also set a timer for 15 minutes at a time if I'm tackling a large task. Bravo! I'll work for 15 minutes and then decide if I need a small break or if I can keep going. When I take a break, I walk away from the task completely, and only for 5 or 10 minutes that I set the timer for. And then I go back for 15 more minutes of work. I do this until I reach a stopping point, have to do another task like make dinner or if my kids need me. Wow, Cassandra, that's a fantastic plan that I really am so glad you shared with all of us. I just wanna go back to the grit process. So we've talked about G, get situated, R, resist distraction, I, implement incentives that matter, and finally, T, take small steps and talk yourself through tasks positively. So instead of saying to yourself, why can't I get this done? What's wrong with me? You want to say, look, I'm making progress. I'm efforting. I'm moving along. It may be slower than I would like, but I'm actually doing a little bit. And that's enough to keep me going to do a little bit more. And so you want to model this for your kids, the way Cassandra has shared. And you want to help your kids notice when they're actually doing things that they're supposed to be doing and making progress. The way I like to think about doing that is to maybe sit down at dinner and everybody can say a happy or a crappy, something that went well for them today and something that wasn't ideal, or a low and a high, just to get kids to shift into some positive perceptions about themselves, because we want to practice that skill when we're not under stress so we can actually find it and we know what it feels like to use when we are. Susan says, I don't blame myself when the kids were, I didn't blame myself when the kids were little to have a messy house. My kids are at college now. Okay. Lori, my daughter hated reading. I put Polly Pockets on top of the fridge. When she finished a book, she could earn the toy. All right. That sounds very helpful. She's now an avid reader, far out. I love that. Anita, you've never seen the table set faster, I'm sure, and without fighting or complaining. When it's hard, maybe do it with them. I agree. Jennifer, suggestion for morning routine. I told my kiddos that if they want extra screen time in the morning, which I try not to allow because it's hard to get them off. Yep. I tell them if they have done everything and are ready to go, they can sit in the car with their Kindle. It hasn't happened yet, but the carrot is out there. Fantastic. Let's see. Oops, hold on a second. Brian, today my friend video chatted me on with me on Facebook and it helped me get through the day. Wonderful. Peter, is showing up late for work or appointments a trait of ADHD because it is so incredibly difficult to get to those things on time? If people, coworkers, knew how hard it was just to get to work, it would help me a lot because that's a daily struggle for me. Yes, I mean, time management is an executive functioning skill that many people with ADHD struggle with, and many people without ADHD struggle with. So, you know, I think if you're struggling this much, Peter, it might be worth having a talk with your boss or some coworkers and let them know one or two areas where you're struggling and ask them if they have any ideas or how they could support, if they'd be interested in supporting you, and talk it out. Oksana, I'm efforting. I'm gonna start using this. It will actually make me work harder compared to I'm trying. Right, because the difference between I'm trying is, it's like you're trying, but you're not getting it. You're not actually there. And with efforting, it's like you're in it. You're doing it, you're moving along. And that's what we want. And we can even share that with our kids, right? What is it that Yoda says? Do not, like, try not, do, or something like that. And so I think that trying can really, the focus on trying can be very frustrating because you feel like, well, I'm trying, but I'm not, like, it's like I'm treading water, I'm not getting anywhere. So, you know, any kind of verbal reframe you can do is very helpful. I used to, now I give myself way too much time and often end up super early. I see. There is no try, only do. Thank you, Angie. I actually love that. I'm so glad you said that. I'm going to write that down right now because that is what I could not remember. Okay. Do or do not, there is no try. Okay. Thanks for sharing that, Annie. Okay, do or do not, there is no try. I use this with clients all the time. And the thing is, what we want to think about is, what I like about that do or do not is it doesn't have to be, you know, a huge do. It can be a small do and you're still doing. And that's kind of where I want to wrap things up today on motivation. No worries, Angie, thanks for saying it. Good for you, Karen. Where I want to wrap this up is in thinking about the grit process, because when you're using grit as a tool, as a process, you're actually efforting, you're doing, and that's what we want to work on doing. So I'm going to write in the my downloadable here about the Harness Grit and Get It Done. I've shared this before, but in case you don't have it, I encourage you to get it. It is very harder. It's much harder than you think for some to do. I agree. I understand that. I know that. And what I want to tell you is you want to break things down. If you struggle with time management, I struggle with time management. So I really understand this. I'm embarrassingly late to things. I don't like this about myself. And I'm working very hard on changing it because it causes me a lot of stress. And perhaps we can do a Facebook on time management. I think we've done one before, but I'm happy to revisit this. Okay, so thank you, Susan, for your comment. Thank you, Sade. Thank you, Karen. What are your list of alternatives, Karen, if you're not ready for doing? So Yes, Cassandra, time blindness is my nemesis. I feel time, but I think I can always do more in a given amount of time. And I think if you're not ready to do, then what I want you to think about is what you're saying to yourself, and what might help you take a small step. Because remember, a baby step is still a step in a direction. And I think what happens for a lot of people with ADHD is that there's this kind of paralysis. And it's almost paralysis by analysis. I see this thing I have to do. I have so much to do. I don't know where to start. And maybe to say, I'm learning how to motivate myself. I'm learning how to break things down, rather than forcing yourself to say, I need to break this down, or I should know how to do that. So we want to use encouraging language with ourselves. Thank you so much for joining me today. We will not be meeting next week, but we will be back in 2 weeks, and I'm very much looking forward to seeing you all then. I hope you have a good weekend, and it's wonderful to be here again with you today. Bye.